Do the sound at my studio, and I'm going to direct the first picture. And the studio's all excited about the thing. So noon the next day, the projection room was absolutely full of people to see the first talking in there. So the thing goes on and gets to the end of the scene, and somebody says, "That's good." I'm a little annoyed. I'm directing the picture, I'd written the picture, and I decide what's good or bad. And the next scene went on, and again it said, same voice, "That's good." I'm a little madder. The third scene comes on, the voice on the same, and I'm stop the projection room. I directed this picture. I run this studio. I'm going to decide whether the thing is good or bad. Now, who the hell is it in this outfit that is saying that's good after the finish of every one of my scenes? And there was a silence for a few seconds, and then the girl that does the thing and says, "I'm sorry, Mr. Roach, but that's you."
Thank you, boy. Where'll you be when I need you?
Right here.
Okay.
I told you not to make that last payment.
When Hollywood was going through the great changeover into sound, I think there were some rare cases where the personality came out stronger than it had been before. I think Ronald Coleman was such a case. And I think Laurel and Hardy were such a case. I think in all cases it had to do with the voice, the quality of the voice, and how well that voice fit the preconceived idea of the character.
How does it look? Never looked better in all its life. Well, bring it over, because I'm as hungry as a hunter.
Where's the rest of it?
It's shriveled.
Well, I'm glad you didn't bring a sardine.
This is a Laurel and Hardy script for a film they made in 1932 called Scram. And the film runs 20 minutes, but this script is only about 6 pages. And as you might be able to see, it's simply an outline of the action for the film. It's not really detailed as to all of the comedy material. And certainly there's no suggestion of camera angles or editing or anything like that. It's just a mere outline of the action that's supposed to go on in the film. And occasionally you can see here 2 or 3 lines of dialogue, but that's it. Generally, the dialogue was improvised on the set.
The night before he'd shoot something, some of the writers, Charlie Rogers and Harry Langdon and people like that, would come over and they would laugh, and I can remember a lot of laughter coming from the den. I can also remember, the den smelled so bad when they'd leave, because some of them were cigar smokers and smokers, and I was always glad to see them go out the front door.
Babe never participated. Babe was always out on the golf course, Riviera. He'd be a good golfer, and he would always come in around 9 or 10 o'clock driving in from the golf course. But Stan always stayed on.
Their personalities were completely different, and it was sort of the attraction of opposites in that regard, because Oliver, Babe, brilliant as he was in the day's work in the shooting, at the end of it, that was the end until tomorrow. Not so with Stan. There was still cutting to be done and timing and testing those scenes in front of an audience at some little neighborhood theater somewhere where they could sneak the pictures. But Babe left all that to Stan, quite rightfully so. I mean, they didn't need two geniuses at work on these pictures.
The early 30s were the golden age for Laurel and Hardy, and with the birth of his daughter Lois, Stan seemed both personally and professionally fulfilled.
He thought the world of Babe and thought he was really a funny, funny man. When he'd watch the films, he wouldn't be watching himself. He was always watching Babe. And Babe knew that my father would make the best decision. Like, if he wrote something, maybe they'd try it three ways, but my father would have the say-so of which way they did it to go, because he knew what worked. It was the love and respect that they had for one another. They were one of a kind team. They just belonged.
Stan knew that at the end of the afternoon, Oliver wanted to get home and get to his club and play golf and have a card game and so forth. So he would wait sometimes for the late afternoon in order to shoot the close-up of Babe that was needed for a scene. And he would get that sort of petulant look in the eye because of his irritation at being kept there so long.
Will you stop making that noise? If you can't play a tune, put it down.
Timing was so beautiful. You know, you see other comedians trying to do situation comedy like they did, and they don't have that timing like Stan and Babe had. They knew those looks, and when they drop the head and look up with the eyes, all of those things, they were so beautifully timed, and they were human beings. You know, they weren't comics. I don't like that word. They were comedians.
Why they were so good was you do a gag that's funny, and now you cut to one of them, and the reaction is another laugh. Then you cut to the other guy, and that was still another laugh. I mean...